Hi, everybody. Trevor Noah here. And today, I'm at Johns Hopkins Medicine in Baltimore, Maryland, where I'm going to be meeting with one of the leading radiologists in the field, Dr. Elliot K. Fishman. We're here today to discover how human ingenuity is confronting one of the deadliest cancers known to man, pancreatic cancer. My big question for him is, how are clinicians using AI to accelerate early detection? And what does this mean for all of the people who are battling this deadly disease?
You can't find answers without asking the right questions. This is The Prompt with me, Trevor Noah.
Dr. Fishman, thank you so much for taking the time.
It's a pleasure.
You know, on this journey that I've been on with Microsoft and the team that's been pushing AI for good, I get to meet some of the most fascinating people who are oftentimes working on the most complicated problems. And it feels like you are working on a problem that for many years has seemed unsolvable. And now there seems to be a new glimmer of hope. What is it about pancreatic cancer that makes it such a difficult challenge in relation to other cancers, which are already a challenge unto themselves?
Right. Pancreatic cancer, the problem is there is really no good therapy. The only thing that really works is surgery. But at surgery, you need to have it when it's small, when there's no involvement of adjacent structures like vessels. And when you look at it, 85% of patients, when they present, they're unresectable, which is why the survival at pancreatic cancer is 11% at 5 years.
Wait, so just help me understand this. So 85% of patients who come in and have pancreatic cancer, you cannot operate on them because it's
cancer
too
has
late?
Spread locally, yeah. Because we're not doing early detection. Early enough detection,
right.
You're not able to really see the patients when you could make a difference.
That really seems like you have a small window to detect something that is oftentimes undetectable because from my understanding, diagnosing pancreatic cancer is extremely difficult because most people don't realize they have it because there aren't any symptoms. Is that correct?
Yeah, I mean, the problem is when you talk about a tumor that's 2 centimeters, so it's about an inch, even if it's on the scan, people miss it more than 40% of the time.
Wow.
If we leave things the way they are now, the way we're doing business as it is, mm-hmm. It's not good.
So when it comes to pancreatic cancer, at what point does AI become a tool that doctors can use to leapfrog them into a different world?
Okay, so if we say you're missing 40% of tumors that are resectable or 2 centimeters, You basically need to teach the computer how to read the scans. You need to train the computer to be able to see what you can't see. I'll show you some of the 3D stuff we do. One of the things we train the computer to do is to look for the duct. And there's the stomach, there's the duct. And if it sees the duct and it sees beyond a certain size and it sees a transition, it says there must be a tumor here.
Okay.
And if you ask me, you may not see the tumor, but I'll tell you that 99% of the time there's a tumor there.
So we're not necessarily seeing the tumor here, but we are seeing the effects of the tumor.
Exactly.
Okay.
Now, when we look at it here, here's a little fancier, right? So this is a cinematic rendering. We scanned the patient, which took 10 seconds. So you have all the organs, and the computer recognizes every organ. It then finds the pancreas, takes the pancreas out, and analyzes it for its density, for its structure, looking at changes in shape. The earliest change might be a change in shape.
Just the shape alone.
And it might be 2 years in advance. And so what we're able to do is think about things as a volume. And then here it sees the pancreatic duct that's mm-hmm. dilated. Mm-hmm. And here that's the tumor.
And how early is this, would you say, in the progression of the cancer?
It's very hard to predict how pancreatic cancer grows. That's why, you know, that early detection is so critical. Without that, you really can't do much. If you think about missing 40%, if we could only miss 10%, let's say, I'll just say that, mm-hmm. that would save 30,000 lives a year.
In a dream scenario, how soon do you think this becomes ubiquitous? How far are we away from having this technology everywhere, in every hospital, with every doctor who's treating people's cancers?
Well, some things like breast imaging is now becoming mainstream. You know, if you look at that, more than half the places now have AI for breast imaging. I think the pancreas, we need to do a little bit better. I don't want to be overly optimistic and say 2 years from now, but in the short term, our goal is not to say, well, over the next 30 years, we're going to change things. Patients are sick now. There's 61,000 patients a year that get pancreatic cancer in the US, and almost 50,000 of them die. Our goal is to change the paradigm of how patients are managed.
Right.
We need to change the world now.
Is there anything that you've learned from how AI is applied to this that maybe makes you want to change how maybe the medical industry works, you know, because it's always interesting when tech intersects with another industry and how the two learn from each other.
The truth is, the companies outside of medicine really can have the biggest impact on medicine. So if medicine wants to move forward, they need to work closely with the best computer scientists, because we understand the problem, they know how to find solutions. And so working together, it's just the ideal.
Well, Elliot, thank you so much for your time.
My pleasure.
And I appreciate the work you're doing.
My pleasure. Thank you very much.